discover the journey of our young democracy. In ANC, we were witnesses to the defining moments of Philippine history that influenced the world.
To the service of the nation.
We talk to leaders. We don't shy away from difficult conversations.
ANC Leadership Series.
We don't just tell stories. We tell you why they matter. We sift through the noise and arm you with facts.
We report about disruption and how the latest technology and innovation have changed the way we live.
We told stories about crisis, but also about opportunities that came with it.
The Philippines.
And we are ANC.
The views and opinions expressed in the following program do not necessarily reflect the policies and position of this network.
Welcome to Matters of Fact. I'm Christian Esguerra. Today on the program, we'll talk about this new policy by the Interagency Task Force on the COVID-19 pandemic, requiring local government units here in the Philippines not to inform the people about the brand of vaccines that will be administered to them until they get to the actual vaccination centers. Now, how exactly will this solve the problem of vaccine hesitancy? Or could it only lead to more speculations or, in fact, more problems when it comes to the vaccination drive by the Philippine government? We begin in the Middle East, where a ceasefire has taken effect between Israel and Hamas, potentially ending 11 days of conflict and violence. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu's office says his security cabinet had voted unanimously in favor of the Gaza truce proposed by Egypt. This came into force by 2 a.m. on Friday, that's 7 a.m. here in Manila. Egypt will monitor the truce and will send two security delegations to Tel Aviv and Palestinian territories. The cross-border violence has killed more than 230 Palestinians, including 65 children, and injured close to 2,000 others. Tens of thousands have also been displaced. Authorities, meanwhile, put the death toll in Israel at 12, with 100 others wounded.
These hostilities have resulted in the tragic deaths of so many civilians, including children. And I send my sincere condolences to all the families, Israeli and Palestinian, who have lost loved ones, and my hope for a full recovery for the wounded. The United States is committed to working with the United Nations, and we remain committed to working with the United Nations and other international stakeholders to provide rapid humanitarian assistance and to marshal international support for the people of Gaza and the Gaza reconstruction efforts. I believe the Palestinians and Israelis equally deserve to live safely and securely and to enjoy equal measures of freedom, prosperity, and democracy.
Here at home, Philippine President Rodrigo Duterte may seek the counsel of his predecessors to discuss China's incursions in the West Philippine Sea. This as he belittles the usefulness of the National Security Council in addressing the maritime dispute. Pia Gutierrez tells us more.
Malacanang tells Filipino fishermen to ignore China's annual three-month fishing ban in the South China Sea, which covers parts of Philippine waters. Presidential spokesman Harry Roque says countries cannot enforce domestic laws outside of their territory. He also assured fishermen the Philippine Coast Guard will protect their interests.
Wala pong extraterritorial application ng mga batas ng mga dayuhang bansa. No? So, dyan lang po kayo sa ating mga traditional na fishing grounds at nandyan naman po ang ating Coast Guard para pangalagaan din po ang interest ng ating mga mangingisda.
Manila has filed a diplomatic protest against Beijing's fishing ban, which the Department of Foreign Affairs says does not have any basis in international law. But as Manila calls out China over the fishing ban, former Senator and Armed Forces of the Philippines Chief Rodolfo Biazon criticized the Duterte administration's different pronouncements on the West Philippine Sea. He says the disparate statements not only confuse Filipinos, but give pause to allies that could help the country block China's moves. And roping in former Senator Juan Ponce Enrile to talk about the issue didn't help at all, according to Biazon.
Dahil iba-iba ang nadidinig sa atin, iba-ibang body language ang nababasa nila, kaya hindi nila alam ano ba talaga ang posisyon ng Pilipinas. Halimbawa, madidinig yung Secretary of Foreign Affairs, madidinig yung Secretary of Defense. Eh ngayon, baka pinubusalan na sila. Eh sila ang dapat madinig natin eh. Sila ang dapat madinig ng ibang bansa. It is up now for the two houses of Congress to file a resolution, adopt a resolution asking the President to call for a National Security Council meeting.
Malacanang, however, sees no value in bringing in the National Security Council to discuss the West Philippine Sea issue. Roque said nothing has ever been resolved by convening the NSC. Instead of calling in senior national security advisors and cabinet officials to advise on the issue, President Duterte is looking to get counsel from several personalities, including former Philippine presidents.
Pero ang tingin po niya, yung mga karanasan nga siya niya sa National Security Council, eh walang resolusyon na nangyayari. No? So parang bakit pa? Eh pwede naman po yan through informal consultations.
Maritime expert Greg Pauling says, without strong opposition, China will get away with its fishing ban. Pauling maintains both the Philippines and Vietnam, which also has claims in the disputed waters, need to be more assertive to protect their interests.
If one doesn't actually protest the ban, China has the ability to de facto administer it. And so China will be able to say that Manila acceded to it, right? Manila, by not objecting, in essence, recognized it. And that's some precedent that the Philippine government can't afford.
China's aggressive actions in the West Philippine Sea is a growing concern for Japan. In a 20-minute phone conversation with President Duterte Wednesday night, Japanese Prime Minister Yoshihide Suga voiced opposition over China's unilateral attempts to change the status quo in the East China Sea and the South China Sea. This includes China's passage of a controversial law that allows its Coast Guard to fire on foreign vessels that do not obey orders to leave what they claim as part of Chinese waters. Pia Gutierrez, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine Coast Guard installs buoys at Benham Rise. These will serve as markers of the exclusive economic zone of the Philippines. The Coast Guard says the presence of the buoys indicates the area is considered a special protected zone. This means mining and oil exploration are strictly prohibited. The buoys have a remote monitoring system and can transmit data to the Coast Guard headquarters in Manila. 7 more state-of-the-art light and ocean buoys will arrive in the country this year. These will mark other parts of the Philippines as EEZ. Joining us now is former Senator and Armed Forces Chief of Staff General Rodolfo Biazon. Thank you for joining us, sir, and welcome to the program.
Thank you, Christian, for this invitation because I think there is a lot of things to be clarified.
Okay, definitely. And we need to hear more voices as far as how the Duterte administration has been dealing with the China issue in the West Philippine Sea. Let's start with the response of Malacanang to your proposal, to your push to convene for President Duterte to once and for all convene the National Security Council. So basically, according to Malacanang, according to Secretary Roque, they would prefer informal consultations, including with people, including former presidents, because according to him, nothing much has been resolved when you gather the National Security Council. How do you respond?
Well, of course, that is we respect that kind of a response from our primary leader, the prime leader of the country, the president of the republic. The constitution allowed the president of the republic to convene the National Security Council. This is so stated in certain executive orders that were issued by, I think, former President Cory Aquino, and then followed through by former President Ramos. Now, the creation of the National Security Council is so that it can help shape the structure of national policies, including foreign policies. Because here, I was a bit alarmed when I noticed from pronouncements and body languages of our leaders that there is no one united, clear position of the government as regards to the West Philippine Sea. Remember that we are not playing alone here. We are playing under an international setting. That's the reason why hindi dapat natin sinasabi yung binabanggit tungkol sa magkakagyera, no? That's a very far possibility.
Okay.
But what I'm saying is, let us elevate our pursuit of our interest in the West Philippine Sea by making mention or basing our actions on three legal documents. Number one, the United Nations Convention of the Law of the Sea, which was signed by more than 150 nations, including China. China signed the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea. The second document would be the Philippine Baseline Law.
Mm-hmm.
We back when I was nearing my end of terms in the Senate, the United Nations asked for a copy of our Philippine Baseline Law, you know? And that's the reason why I authored a revision or a edition, no? And that it was my proposal that was approved by both Congress, no? The Philippine Baseline Law. Now, so the third one that we have to refer to and should be helping pushing the executive department into performing its functions relative to the issue, you know, is the ruling of the Permanent Court of Arbitration in The Hague. Mm-hmm. I was there. I was invited to attend the hearing. As a matter of fact, I am very glad to hear Ambassador of Australia last night. I was able to hear, to read this morning, the reaction of the Prime Minister.
Okay.
Kasi the Prime Minister, the Japanese groups of, there were five groups of Japanese lawmakers and diplomats that came to see me when I was still in the House of the Representatives. They were asking us, ano ba ang posisyon ng Pilipinas dito sa issue na ito? Ano? Because they are interested. Eh. As a matter of fact, when I attended the hearings in The Hague, together with Justice Carpio, Soljen Hilbay, yan mga kasama ko, and other personalities. Nandun doon din si Secretary Del Rosario. He was there. You know? I noticed that about five countries in Asia, like including an observer from Australia, observer from Japan, observer from Indonesia, etc. And there were other countries. I asked them, why are you here observing these proceedings in the court of Permanent Court of Representatives in The Hague? This is a Philippine issue. You know what they told me? Sabi nila, we are here because we are interested in the case of the West Philippine Sea. Yeah,
as right? Can be applied to them as well.
That is correct.
But
so
sir,
sabi nila,
Okay.
Sabi nila, if you win, if the Philippine wins, we also win. Sabi nila. Yeah. Sabi ko sa kanila, hindi pa tapos ang usapan if we win. Tayo na naman ang mag-uusap-usap dahil yung overlapping claims ng Philippines, Indonesia, etc., etc. And I told the Japanese, I am looking, we, no nation, Kako, can challenge China's aggression dyan alone. This must be addressed by a coalition of nations, ano, using international law as the basis. Sabi ko ganon. So I am, sabi ko sa Japanese, I am looking at you, Japan, leading the coalition of nations from Asia. Sabi ko sa kanya. And
but Senator Biaso, sorry to cut you off. These things are clear already, the legal basis of our
that is correct
maritime entitlements. But what do you think the National Security Council, if convened once and for all by President Duterte, could achieve? And where do you think the biggest problem lies when it comes to the Philippines' approach to the West Philippine Sea problem under President Duterte?
Okay, disconnect. Meaning, what do we hear? Different positions from different political sectors, positions from even civilian organizations, you know? And we can, I am confused. Ano ba ang position natin? And that is, kung sana hindi lang ako ang, sana ako lang ang confused. What if our potential allies, our potential friends, who we need to support us. And I am glad reading the newspaper this morning, no? Yung statement ng Australian ambassador, yung statement ng Japanese ambassador, that is what we need if we foresee this. Now, the only thing is, hindi lang tayo ang naku-confuse, hindi lang yung policymakers ang naku-confuse, including our potential allies and potential friends. And the worst is, kung ang nalito ay yung kalaban natin, halimbawa, sinasabi natin, oh, kontrolado na nila yan, which indicates some sort of acquiescence to their possession.
Kasi submissiveness, yan.
Oo. Ginamit yung, yung term na China is in possession. Ano ba ang implication nun? That we have surrendered the pursuit of our interest in the West Philippine Sea.
But that statement came from President Duterte himself. So don't you think this confusion is all caused by the president himself?
No. Let us not pinpoint.
But our, he was the one who said that.
Our intention now is through the convening of the National Security Council formulate a united, clear position of the Philippines, ano, that will encourage the allies to help us more. For example, yesterday I was glad to hear from the Australian ambassador that Australia is earmarking 6 patrol boats or patrol ships to be given to us. Why do they do this? Because of the global interest in maintaining peace and order in that channel. 5 to 6 trillion dollars worth of trade and commerce dumadaan dyan. At as a matter of fact, yung Japanese statement ni Japan Prime Minister kanina na about 65% of Japanese trade and commerce movement passes through that. Kaya nga, we have the world on our side. Let us not scare them.
Okay.
Let us now allow them to continue to help us.
Okay. Now, this is not purely about pointing fingers or pinning blame on people, but definitely we need to also exact accountability here, because when you talk about confusion or disconnect when it comes to messaging or pronouncements, the administration members of the cabinet all point to the president as the chief architect of Philippine foreign policy. Now, that's why we also need to address the problem or the question. To be honest then, about it, is the biggest problem the president because of his pronouncements regarding this?
I will not play along with finger pointing, you know. You are right. What you are saying is correct, you know. But let us focus not on the issue of the possibility of war.
But who's talking about war here? But who's talking about war? The possibility of war, aside from the president and his allies? Because that is a very simplistic dichotomy.
Exactly. Kaya nga gusto kong hilahin yung usapan away from guerra. We should focus on the legal basis of our pursuit of our interest. Makakatulong kay presidente yan. Halimbawa, the National Security Council puts out through some kind of process, puts out or recommend a clear, united position of the president of the Philippines regarding the issue at hand. West Philippine Sea.
Assuming that happens, a unified position once and for all, a clear and unified position. But what if the president afterwards says something discordant once again? Let's say something to the effect like he will be in possession of the West Philippine Sea.
Then he will be subject to the judgment of our people. He will be subject to the judgment of the people all over the globe. Ano? Na, kaya nga sabi ko, yung National Security Council can help the president say na ito, wala tayong magagawa. Ito yung gusto ng Pilipino eh. Ito yung sinasabi ng National Security Council eh. I may be the head of the National Council because I am the one who has the power to call the National Security Council. Kaya nga nagpunta ako sa Senado to discuss this matter so that hoping that if the two houses of Congress, Senate and the House of Representatives says ito ang dapat nating sundan. And to me, ang dapat talaga nating sundan is the legal way. The legal way. Meron tayo ng ano eh, references eh.
UNCLOS, you have the victory.
Yeah. Oh, yes, et cetera, et cetera. And there are other laws that we can use. For example, but environmental laws is one. Kaya nga, nakikita ko rito, kala nga makisama dyan yung Department of Agriculture because of the Bureau of Fisheries. Kasi ito, this is a security threat to us, the Filipinos. Ano yan? One, territorial security. Remember, we created a town. Ang town na yan ay yung Kalayaan town. At yung nandoon ng ating gobyerno, the seat of government of that town is in Pagasa. So there is a territorial threat in addition to our capability to protect our whole territory. Now, there is another threat, the threat to food security. Yeah. So plainly, this is a national security concern. Kaya yung national security can help the president, National Security Council.
But how confident or optimistic are you that the two chambers of Congress would come up with such a resolution asking the president to convene the National Security Council and actually come out with a unified position regarding this?
Yeah. I am receiving some from some members of the Senate. Siguro madidinig nyo na rin yan o nakita nyo na yung sinabi ni Tito Soto, President Soto. Mm. Yung and other center, I will not mention names anymore, no? But I am hopeful that through the legislature encouraging the president to put together something that can help us, that can help the president put together a clear, unified Philippine position vis-a-vis the national security threat in the West Philippine Sea. I will now call it national security threat. Kasi okay, nandun doon, may territorial implication, merong yung food security, etc. I was the author of the Philippine Baseline Law. Tatlo ang boundaries na that is defined in that. One is the territorial sea. No? Yan yung supreme, yung ating sovereignty. Complete ang ating sovereignty dyan. Mm-hmm. Ano? Ngayon, yung susunod na boundary is the boundary of the contiguous seas. Another 12 miles from the baseline. And then, the third boundary is the exclusive economic zone boundary, 200 miles from our baseline.
And sovereign
rights. Kaya yan, may mga, ang ipupush natin ngayon dapat is the legal basis for pursuing our interests in the West Philippine Sea.
Okay, but don't you think it's a bit too late for certain politicians or members of Congress to make this push at this time? When in fact, over the past few years, they've been playing along with the president and also using that line, he's the chief architect of the Philippine foreign policy. I mean,
Christian,
if you talk about the real issue here, I mean, politics really plays a lot in terms of their position.
I agree. Because being a democracy, you know, the prime mover in a democracy are the people. The people. So if we project to the present, for example, ito ang gusto ng taong bayan. Ito ang gusto ng mga mangingisda sa West Philippine Sea. Ito ang gusto ng bayan ng kalayaan. Etc. So if I think the president will listen, because to me, I look at this as if these positions that we are wanting for is formulated through the National Security Council, the president is armed. Ang sasabihin niya, wala na akong magagawa niya kung ano man ang aking gusto, pero ito yung gusto ng Pilipino eh.
Okay, I understand the position that you're taking, but don't you think we would also put our credibility at risk here? Because if you, let's say, go by how the international community is seeing the Philippine position under President Duterte, 1 year before he leaves office and all of a sudden there would be a unified position, would they believe, let's say, the position that suddenly we are taking regarding this? Or let's say a shift?
You listen to the in the words this morning of the prime minister of Japan. You listen, namnamin natin kano ang sinasabi nitong prime minister na ito. Ano? Namnamin natin yung sinasabi ni Ambassador Robinson ba yan? Ng Australia.
Stephen Robinson.
This can be the trigger for other countries to come out and help us push the rule of law in the West Philippine Sea. And what is the law in the Philippine Sea? UNCLOS? Ulitin ko na naman. Philippine Baseline Law and
the PCA ruling.
PCA ruling. So ayun ang ano, we do not need to confuse our potential allies. We must be very clear to them. And the indications are they are going to support us. Halimbawa, yung bibigyan tayo ng 6 na patrol ships ba yun ng Australia?
Okay.
Yung bang Australia is so very kind, bibigyan tayo niya. Hindi, because they are interested, as the other countries in the world are interested in maintaining legal status of the West Philippine Sea.
Okay.
Upor kadugtong yan ng ano ng East Philippine Sea. Kaya affected din Japan eh.
Yeah, because they're also affected with whatever is happening in the South China Sea, a vital sea lane as far as global trade is concerned. Well, former Senator Pong Biason, thank you very much for joining us this morning, sir.
It's my pleasure. And you know, sana ako, sabi ko sarili ko, retired ka na eh. Bakit ka pa makikialam? You know, I retired as a public servant after serving this republic for more than 60 years. You know?
Okay.
And then, however, I have not retired as a citizen of this country, okay, as a Filipino. Kaya nga, Nung madinig kong may lumalabas na namang ibang mga comments dyan, ako'y nataranta. And that's the reason why I decided the other day to go to the Senate to discuss the possibility of convening the National Security. Remember, the National Security Council can help the president.
Okay. Unfortunately, we have no more time left, but thank you very much for expressing your views on the matter. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Christian. And marami pong salamat sa inyo lahat. Sana magkaisa tayo.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Up next, a discussion on the government's brandless vaccination strategy and the long road to herd immunity. Matters of Fact will be right back.
Filipinos, for example, having a family-oriented culture in the office is a big thing. Having a very collaborative environment or team approach to a lot of things they do is a big thing. Filipinos, even if a lot of folks are not as financially fortunate as our Western counterparts, you would find there's so much into giving to the less fortunate folks.
Welcome back to Matters of Fact. President Rodrigo Duterte issues a directive meant to prevent crowding at vaccination centers. But as Adrian Ayelin tells us, the order not to announce vaccine brands in advance is not sitting well with some Metro Manila mayors.
On the first day of the rollout of Pfizer vaccines against COVID-19 in Marikina City, residents were extremely satisfied they were inoculated with their preferred brand.
It's my own health, which is at stake, di ba? So, parang privilege ko to choose my own vaccine. Kasi health ko yung concern ko above anything else.
Only 5,400 doses of Pfizer vaccines were allocated to the city government, but Mayor Marcy Teodoro stressed the importance of respecting the rights of individuals to choose their vaccine brand.
Informed consent ang hinihingi natin para dun sa medical eligibility. Paano kung yung bakunang gagamitin sa kanya ay hindi akma dun sa comorbidities na meron siya o hindi tama dun sa kanyang medical condition. Kaya nga, bago pa isaksak yung bakuna ulit, pinapaliwanag ulit kung anong produkto, kung anong epekto nito doon sa taong tatanggap nito.
Former National Task Force Against COVID-19 advisor Dr. Tony Liachon also believes that it is a basic right to be allowed to choose a brand of vaccine amid success stories in Western countries, especially against emerging variants of the coronavirus. Liachon initially favored the decision of President Rodrigo Duterte, who balked at the idea of allowing the public to pick their preferred jabs, arguing that it delays the achievement of herd immunity and causes health protocol violations. Duterte's decision for local government units not to announce the vaccine brand comes after people crowded a recent vaccination rollout where a Western-made vaccine was made available. The palace further argues all brands are effective against COVID-19.
So, lahat naman po ng bakuna ay pantay-pantay. Dumaan po yan sa masusing pag-aaral, lahat po yan ligtas at epektibo. Kaya nga po ang pinakamabuting bakuna yung ilalagay sa inyong mga braso.
Interior and Local Government Secretary Eduardo Anyo released a statement, individuals will still be informed when they reach the vaccination site.
Sa araw mismo, pagdating ng individual, ay kung magtatanong siya, ay kailangan sabihin sa kanya dahil that's part of the rights of the patient.
If the recipient does not like the available vaccine, that recipient will have to wait for all the people in his category in his community to be inoculated before getting another chance to be vaccinated. Health Secretary Francisco Duque also underscored the importance of getting a jab right away over waiting for a preferred brand.
Anong pipiliin mo sa dalawa? Yung benepisyo ng COVID, COVID vaccine, napakamataas. Ano? Yung risk, napakamababa. Yung benepisyo, anong benepisyo naman? Magka-COVID ka, wala. Pero ang risk, napakamataas. Ano pipiliin mo sa dalawa?
Local governments such as Pasay City backed the palace, reiterating that choosing and waiting for vaccines will slow down efforts to reach herd immunity. San Juan also wants to go by the Malacanang order for an on-the-spot release of information which can also be refused by the vaccine recipient. Mandaluyong City also stated that even before the DILG released its directive, it has decided to keep information about vaccine brands up to the last hour. Navotas City said it will send an appeal letter to the DILG noting that if overcrowding is the only problem, it can be solved through an organized way of scheduling individuals and prohibiting the entry of walk-ins. Adrian Ayalin, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippines' supply of Pfizer doses from the vaccine-sharing facility COVAX is set to go to indigent Filipinos. That's according to Malacanang spokesman Harry Roque. He says this is in compliance with the policy of COVAX where its vaccines go to the most vulnerable. He also notes that the president wants the vaccine distributed in communities where uptake is low and not in malls. Hundreds of people swarmed to malls this week in hopes of getting the American-made vaccine. The Philippines expects to receive a second shipment of 2.2 million more Pfizer doses from COVAX this month. New tests conducted by BioNTech show the COVID-19 vaccine it developed with Pfizer is still highly effective against the India variant. The preliminary studies had shown that the B.1.617 variant spreads more easily, with some evidence showing it may be able to evade some protections provided by existing vaccines. BioNTech says when the blood of vaccinated people was exposed to the variant, 25 to 30% fewer antibodies were detected. This suggests protection is a bit lower, but still at 70 to 75%. The Pfizer-BioNTech vaccine is around 95% effective against the original version of the virus. The government and the private sector are studying the possibility of rewarding Filipinos who have been fully vaccinated against COVID-19. Among the options being studied are holding raffles or giving discounts on goods and services for those who are fully vaccinated. Presidential Advisor for Entrepreneurship Joey Concepcion says he will consult with the Philippine Retailers Association and Philippine Franchising Association on what discounts they can offer to vaccinated Filipinos.
Siguro maaring kasama sa sale, no? Pag nagkaroon ng approval dun sa vaccine pass. So may dagdag kang 5%. Sabihin natin na diskwento dun sa inyong sale.
Parang vaccine sale.
Parang ganon. So, creative ways to encourage people okay. to get vaccinated.
Presso.ph, a group of restaurateurs, is already planning to launch a discount program for those who have been vaccinated. The Philippine government is urged to ramp up testing as officials observe a spike in COVID-19 cases outside the NCR Plus bubble. Rafael Busan reports.
The local COVID task force in Palawan believes the national task force's decision to waive the 14-day quarantine for those returning to provinces may have caused the rise in COVID cases in their area. But contact tracing czar Benjamin Magalong says there are other causes for the surge in cases.
Huge surge na experience natin
from March in just 6 days, March 16 to March 21, ang total number of positive cases namin through antigen test is already 64. 6 days coming from different provinces. 6 days. So ibig ko lang sabihin dito, the risk that you have to take or encounter every time travelers come in.
Magalong and other members of the National COVID Task Force who visited Palawan assure the local government it will be prioritized in vaccine deployment to help it deal with the spike in infections.
Ang mga bakuna natin, lalo na dahil limitado, talagang ipaprioritize natin sa mga area na tumataas ang kaso. So definitely magkakaroon ng priority ang Palawan, lalo na ang Puerto Princesa.
Government is turning its attention on the COVID numbers of areas outside the so-called NCR Plus as some regions experience an uptick in cases. If left unabated, these areas may suffer the same predicament as the capital region, where a recent surge in cases threatened to overwhelm healthcare workers and medical facilities. Region 4B alone registered a positivity rate of 55.3%. This means that for every two people tested, one is sure to be confirmed positive. But in the last 2 weeks, average daily testing output in the region was as low as 197. Edson Guido, head of ABS-CBN Data Analytics, says more testing should be done.
Napaka-konti nun if we consider nga yung kanilang positivity rate nga, no? In the past 2 weeks na nasa 55%. Kung ganun yung nakikita nating state nung transmission at napakababa pa rin yung testing numbers na 200 lang or even less for the whole region, ibig sabihin, posibleng mahina yung kanilang contact tracing.
Rafael Bosano, ABS-CBN News.
The downtrend in Metro Manila's COVID-19 cases is seen to continue until the end of May. ABS-CBN Data Analytics Head Edson Guido says this is a result of the stricter quarantine restrictions previously imposed on the region. But Guido says it's still possible infections could rise again in the first half of June after quarantine restrictions were relaxed. The Octa Research Group believes efficient vaccine deployment is crucial to curbing infections throughout the country.
Kailangan maayos, ma-deploy natin yan. Bumaba yung vaccine hesitancy para mas maraming magpabakuna kasi the more na mas maraming magpavaccinate, mas matalaga makakabalik tayo doon sa normal, sa maybe new normal or maybe even old normal pag mga tao na na-vaccinate pare-pareho.
Information campaigns have been government's top strategy in combating vaccine hesitancy. But are there other avenues that can be pursued? Joining us now is Health Undersecretary Mirna Kabutahe. Good morning, Dr. Kabutahe, and thank you for joining us on the program.
Good morning, Christian. Good morning to all your viewers.
This new brand agnostic policy when it comes to COVID-19 vaccinations, it has received quite predictably a lot of concerns, if not criticisms. Shouldn't the government reconsider this new policy not to announce the brand of vaccines until the people actually arrived to the vaccination centers?
Yes, that was in response to the crowding when the brand of the vaccine was announced. No, but this does not take away the right to information of the vaccinee, because at the vaccination site, they will be informed of what vaccine they will be given, and they will also need to sign an informed consent. And our informed consent for vaccination is vaccine specific, stating what are the different side effects for a particular vaccine.
Don't you think that would be a bit too late for the people, because they're already there and they might be forced to take that vaccine?
That is the purpose, that the best available vaccine is the one, the best vaccine is the one that is available. Anyway, we will have only a few vaccines that will be available at a time. For instance, in areas outside of Metro Manila, we only have the Sinovac and the AstraZeneca. So between the two, they will have an idea what vaccines are being distributed. In Metro Manila, now we have the inclusion of Pfizer, but this will almost be gun until we are going to have the next tranche of vaccines.
And how do you think this new policy would exactly address the problem of vaccine hesitancy? Because I don't think they are experiencing some hesitancy when it comes to vaccines in general. Perhaps the problem is with the brand.
Yes, but we should also, we are addressing this through advocacy. We are telling everybody that any vaccine is effective, they are safe, they have passed the EUA, and we cannot be choosy with our brands unless there are really medical contraindications, because we know that we cannot get the supply of the vaccines that we want. There's scarcity in the global market. Galvest, our vaccines are resorted to a portfolio. So to be able to get enough vaccines for the country, they resorted to several portfolio vaccines. So we are considering now 7 vaccines. Currently we have 4, Sinovac, Gamaleya, AstraZeneca, and Pfizer.
Yeah, because definitely this could work when you have a sufficient menu of vaccines available to the people. But even then, don't you think that would violate the people's right to information for primarily? And number two, we're talking here of informed consent, but that would come only once they are there. So some people or a lot of people might feel that they've been ambushed, that there's an announcement of a vaccination, but once they're there, their expectation on exactly what is in front of them.
They are not deprived of the right to information, because we have several updates. We will also have several discussions and several publications, meetings like this that will tell us what are the benefits, what are the efficacy rates of the vaccine. Our bottom line is all vaccines are equal. What is important is they get vaccinated. Anyway, when they are there, then they can have the choice to be vaccinated or not. If they choose not to be vaccinated, then they go to the bottom of the line. I think that is the purpose of this proposed policy, of this policy.
Yeah, we understand the noble intention of those who propose this, because we need to also definitely vaccinate as many people as possible to be able to reach that herd immunity sooner than later. But again, on principle, that is the objective. But in terms of application, for instance, won't this lead to more speculations, for instance, within the community? People asking, would you go to the vaccination center? I have my schedule, but I'm not sure which particular vaccine would be administered to me. I mean, can this actually address this problem?
Maybe there will be some difficulty at the beginning, but when we already advocate and tell the people that all vaccines are the same, and we start talking more and more about the benefits of the vaccine, then they will be enlightened. There is eagerness, no? So there is more eagerness to be vaccinated, and many just want to have the vaccine that is available.
Wouldn't it be better to focus on the messaging by the government as far as the effectiveness or efficacy of the vaccines are concerned, instead of implementing this policy, meaning boost the information campaign that all vaccines, once approved by the regulators, work?
Yes, we are doing that, and we are going to enhance it further and intensify that campaign that all the vaccines boost immunity and they prevent deaths and minimize hospitalization. But I think it's a response to that crowding, because while we want to prevent disease and hospitalization and death with vaccine, when they start crowding, then we are going to have a super spreader, and we will have more transmission of the COVID-19.
But can the crowding be addressed by the local government units with proper information dissemination and proper scheduling and proper enforcement once they get there, instead of resorting to this broad policy?
Yes and no. Yes, because even if you have schedules, if it's announced, then there will be walk-ins and they will try for their turns, whether we like it or not. That happened in one area, no? They were given schedules, but those who were supposed to come shared the information to the others. So the others were not scheduled to be vaccinated, but they came thinking they could have a walk-in. So I think why don't we try this policy? It does not rob anybody of the information. Just
are
the
you
same
open to having
a consent?
Are you open to having this new policy reviewed, let's say after a week or 2 weeks or a month?
Yes, we have been in talks with our government, local government units, especially in Manila, in Metro Manila, in the MMMDA. Yes, but why don't we try this and look at what's going to happen? Anyway, there will be some limiting factors that will be attendant to the vaccine. Now, for instance, we can only give A1, A2, A3, and A5 later on for the COVAX donated vaccine. This is Pfizer and AstraZeneca. So if you are A4, when we open the A4, then you will know that you'll only be getting Sinovac and Gamaleya. So there will be some limitation. You will know what vaccines you will be getting in a way. So it will be a toss between the two that will be available. And also, if you see the pattern of our vaccine distribution, they're not coming all at the same time. So they have the people have an idea what vaccine most likely will be available in the health center.
Undersecretary Kabutahe, if people would have an idea anyway, so why impose this this brand agnostic policy in the first place? Alam na rin pala nila kung ano yung available vaccine based on announcements.
Announcements in general, but then yes, because we do not want them to be just choosing all their vaccines. So when they go to the vaccination center, then they have already made up their mind to be vaccinated or not, and they will just be later on looking whether they'd like the vaccine or not.
Okay, let's also address this one concern. I think this was raised by Marikina Mayor Marcy Teodoro. If the vaccines that will be made available and the brand won't be announced until the people arrive at the vaccination centers, how do you make sure that that particular vaccine available at that time would be appropriate to the condition of that person?
In general, all vaccines are appropriate for the person. What we have to consider is really the severe allergies, in talagang nag-anaphylactic shock, which are common with the Pfizer vaccine and some Moderna. But we have general contraindications and we have general precautions. And I'm sure when those with certain contraindications, some of their doctors have prescribed specific vaccines for certain areas, then they can coordinate with their local health officials.
Okay, finally, Undersecretary Kabutahe, how many people have been fully vaccinated and partially vaccinated as of today? And how soon, at the rate that things are going, how soon can we achieve herd immunity?
We are reaching the 3.5 million jobs for first dose and second dose, all vaccines. No? This is about 45% of our total population target. And in terms of the completed vaccine, two doses, we have already 825,146 for all the A1, A2, A3, and A1, A2, and A3. Still a far cry from our target. But when the vaccines come in steady supply and bigger volume starting in June, July, and August, then we are hoping to have 100 jobs per day, about 500 jobs to 1 million a a week so that we can reach at least by November. And we are focusing in areas, what we call the NCR plus 8, where we have the surge in cases, but not forgetting that we also have to address the increasing cases in other areas.
Okay, Undersecretary Mirna Kabutahe, thank you for joining us this morning.
Thank you.
The United Nations Migration Agency says most overseas Filipino workers who returned home due to the pandemic are struggling to find new jobs. The latest report by the International Organization for Migration shows 83% of the 8,332 OFWs they interviewed from September to December 2020 were still unemployed 3 months after coming back to the Philippines. It says more females were unemployed compared to men, and sea-based OFWs find it more difficult to land new jobs. The report also shows the household income of almost half of the respondents dropped by 60% upon the return. There were over 540,000 OFWs returned to the Philippines due to the pandemic, according to data from the Labor Department. U.S. President Joe Biden signs the COVID-19 Hate Crimes Act into law. The legislation aims to fight violence against Asian Americans, which have risen since the beginning of the pandemic. Activists and police said anti-Asian sentiment was fed by comments from former President Donald Trump, who blamed China for the pandemic. The new law got a rare overwhelming bipartisan support in Congress.
I'm proud today of the United States. I'm proud today of our political system, the United States Congress. I'm proud today that Democrats and Republicans have stood up together to say something. We cannot let the very foundation of this country continue to be eaten away like it has been in other moments in our history and happening again. I looked at this law that you all passed as maybe the first break, the first significant break on a moment in our history that has to be turned around.
The law will expedite the review of hate crimes reported to police during the COVID-19 pandemic. It also provides guidance for local law enforcement agencies to report hate crimes, expand public education campaigns, and combat discriminatory language in describing the pandemic. And that's our show for today, and this has been the final episode of Matters of Fact. You can also catch this interview again on the ANC Matters of Fact podcast, available at Apple, Spotify, Google, and Stitcher. You can also get other exclusive content on ANC's YouTube channel. Now, next Monday, May 24, join us in our new program, After the Fact, 8 to 9 p.m. on ANC. More comprehensive views and more incisive interviews. Thank you for watching.
Violence returns to the streets of Hong Kong. The UN chief also urging world leaders to take the lead in the fight against climate change.
Carmina Constantine bringing you the latest news Monday to Friday at 12 noon on Dateline Philippines. The latest news and information you get on radio, TV, and the internet are now in the ABS-CBN Radio Service app. Stream anytime, anywhere with BZMM Radio Patrol. Plus different podcast content from ABS-CBN News and the ABS-CBN News channel. Download the ABS-CBN Radio Service app now. Available on Google Play Store and Apple App Store. The biggest news. The most compelling stories. And issues that matter to you. Top Story, Monday to Saturday at 5 p.m. here on ANC. Be right,
don't
be
just
first,
throw away questions.
In that order. That's how we break the news. We don't just narrate events as they unfold. We gather insights from all sides to help you see through the spin. That is ANC's Rundown, Monday to Friday at 10 a.m. and 2 p.m. and Saturday at 8 a.m. here on ANC.
several leaders of economy.